Great. Good morning, everyone. Just really nice to be here today and with so many of you that loves the sport of sailing that has shaped my life. And I was really thrilled to be asked to come here by Andy and Kim and co to talk about the future of the Volvo Ocean Race. And sailing is, to me, very appealing in many ways. But what really, really appeals to me are the athletes. And in particularly over the last 30 years, I've got to know the offshore racers that race together in the Whitbread Round the World race. And they are the ones that keep me in the sport. And they are role models for me and my family and many of my friends. But before I talk about the future of the Volvo Ocean Race, I'd just like to tell you a story about resilience of these people, the resilience of the Round the World racers and their ability to keep going. And this was 10 months ago on Christmas Day in Melbourne in Australia, following an extraordinary hard leg from Cape Town, South Africa. And standing there on the dock with Christmas carols in the background and hearing fresh stories from the crew members coming up straight from the Southern Ocean, seeing swollen, cracked hands, frostbites in their faces, a tear of relief in some eyes, and all to this flow of Christmas shoppers that hadn't a clue about what just had happened and what these people had been through. And that really reminded me of the stark contrast that we experience in this world if we look for them. And few people showcases this better and reminds me of this than the sailors who race around the world. And they inspire all of us, and they inspire me to try even harder in everything I do. And study after study has shown that the most important ability you can teach your kid is resilience, and that we need in our life. And that's the ability to bounce back, the ability to keep going no matter what happened. And no one goes through life with an unbroken chain of success. Or we all have setbacks, we all have failures, we all have pressures. But the people who make it in life, they have resilience. And the crew members who make it around the world in the Volvo Ocean Race, they have resilience like few others. And that leg from Cape Town to Melbourne showed us just that. And talking on the dock there that Christmas morning with one of my resilient Kiwi friends, one of those that have done a handful of laps around the world, who have barbed wire for breakfast, and for him a good dinner is a slab of meat and a bottle of rum. He looked me in the eyes and he said this was the hardest leg he had ever done, ever done. And another person, she said that it was the toughest and worst thing she had ever been doing. And I think, Dee, you have forgotten that leg. I don't want to remind you, but it was a tough leg in many aspects. And we saw more wind in this past edition of the Volvo Ocean Race than I think we've seen ever on average. But despite those 50 knots squalls in the dark night, the breakdowns, the tons of cold water crashing over the decks and into the oil skins, the bad skids, they showcased resilience. And they kept coming back. And they came back to good skids. And in the end, they came across the finish line with honors many times. But where do you get this resilience to keep going? Well, you should ask Dee and the other Volvo Ocean racers who are here at the conference today. But to me, it comes from believing, to believing, and even to the point of knowing that if you just get back as fast as you can onto the saddle, something will happen that will bring you back into the plot. So you just keep going. And I think resilience, to all of us who are friends of sailing, is one of these great things that you build if you're a sailor, especially if you're an offshore sailor. So that's good for kids and good for us as adults as well. But now let me tell you a bit about the future of the fully crewed Round the World race. That's what we call it. You have to get used to it. It's pretty long, but no, I'm kidding, of course. We're going to announce the new name reasonably short. It's involved with the registry and so on. It won't be a big surprise to many of you. But what's important to know is that when we took over the race, it felt like an opportunity to really steer the future of what we are talking about in this forum, or be part of steering that, the future of crewed offshore round the world racing. And what we then said, to do it, we really need good support, because we don't want to get into this and then we have to do what most of us have done all life in sailing, try to find money. So we made sure that Volvo, who have been a great partner of the race for over 20 years, they stuck to the race. So we have continuous partnership for at least 5 years with each Volvo company that provides the foundation for securing that we will be able to deliver as good a race. And again, the name will come soon to you. And the last edition of the race was spectacular in many ways. It was the closest, and the finish into The Hague, where we had almost 500,000 people coming down to the race village in The Hague over a few days, was just extraordinary. And with three boats being able to win that day and just a few hours spitting them, that sport, as good as it gets, we're not used to that type of closeness in sailing, and I think we will be lucky if we see it soon again in this race. But it was an extraordinary Sunday afternoon that those of us who experienced it will not forget. And it really was a feeling of that, you know, everyone who crossed that finish line, whether you were first or what your position you were in, had done an outstanding achievement, a real to complete that race that was so hard. And the last race, we also saw more women in total in the fleet, which is a good direction. We are not close to there yet, but we are going in the right direction there. And we also saw the opportunities in this sport of creating really outstanding footage through this concept of the onboard reporters and what was called the raw footage. And sustainability suddenly, you know, awoke. It's been part of the race since 1973, but it's been part of our DNA, but suddenly it found a platform and good people set up a strategy before the race, and it really and inspired and sparked many of us who were involved, and Dee will talk a bit more about that later on. And what we've seen is that the race, as we were told when we were in Cardiff in Wales, that this race brings more economic impact to a city than, for instance, the Champions League final does. And they said that it brought more people than a Ryder Cup final did. So we shouldn't be ashamed of the sport that we are working in. It's wonderful in many aspects, and it works commercially. And it's just how we present it and package it that will bring the future to us. This has, for many editions now, become a very good platform for B2B activities, and so it was this time around. There was a new concept around really trying to grasp the new media, social media, and that's what everyone in sport obviously are trying, and the team working in the Volvo Ocean Race around that were very innovative, trying new things and trial and errors to try to develop something extraordinary. And here's some footage from them, so we can roll this film.
8 months of relentless racing, 12 cities, pushing every inch to win, over 11 legs in brutal conditions. This is the test of sailors, adventurers and racers.
We defy the odds, we cheat the cards, I lead with the ones I've chosen. We can break the
Well, either I sleep soon or I die. Pretty simple.
And leave all the doors wide open. They heard nothing. Nobody saw it coming.
We've come for the great unknown.
No one's falling. No one will be forgotten.
No one's going on their own.
We find light through the smoke. No one stands alone.
Through the fire,
we find hope. No one stands alone.
No one stands alone.
Nice moments. That's what sport is, good moments with good heroes. And so now the question is, where do we go forward with this race? And we want to go forward and we also want to go backward, because we want to tie back more to the traditions of this race. We want to keep the race course, the traditional one, going around the world, of course. And a lot of things have changed around the race, but the waves, the winds, and the land has not changed that much. So it's the same as it was in 1973. But for us, the big changes that has taken place so far, it's a new ownership of the race. It's two classes racing next time around. And we drive the rules to create to support more diversity in terms of gender and age. And we bring sustainability even closer to the heart of the race and the purpose of the race. And I'll talk through each point. And the ownership of the race, this is Johan Salén and myself, and we've been working together for soon 20 years. We were racing against each other in the 89 Whitbread. And we sort of had this passion to work between the sport and the business side of it for many years. And we've been developing how you can create commercial values, in particular around the world racing. But we've also been doing quite a lot around trimarans and multi-hulls and pushing that forward starting 20 years ago. But the red thread through our lives have been this race. So we've been managing teams, some that have been very successful, such as the EF team and the Ericsson team and the Assa Abloy team, and some that have been completely pushing a bit the boundaries forward, like the Team SCA, which was probably one of the most enjoyable teams I ever worked with. And for some reason, we tried to leave this race, but we're always drawn back. So this photo was actually taken a year ago when we were asked to take over the leadership of the race, and little did we then know that we would actually stand here today and soon be the new owners of the race. And we've always said, which hasn't helped us all the time in our relationship with Volvo, that it hasn't been right that the company should own a sport event. They actually called us and said, you know, we realize that it's wrong. Why do we own a sport event? We should be a demanding customer. We should be a demanding sponsor. We don't understand the ins and outs of a boat race and how many dagger boards there should be and so on. So then finally we saw this was a great opportunity, and we created this this basis to take over the race. And it's not something you take on because it's a good business, as you all can understand, or that it's a hard, easy thing to do, but we take it on a bit as to carry the legacy forward, because I don't want this race to go away. I want it to continue. I want to provide the opportunity for more people to do it. It's the most wonderful thing you can do in life, to race this race, and that's why I'm here. And talking of boat classes, we will have the VO65 class back in the next race. It is the third edition, and it's interesting to see that class in the sort of inner circle of the pond we are in. It was considered quite early when it was launched that something was not completely right with it. But that came to a halt, I guess, in May this year, when it set a new 24-hour world record for across the Atlantic, and the people realized they are pretty cool. They are tricky to sail, as Dino. They are very hard to find your sweet spots in, and the speeds have developed from the first to the second edition, and I guess we will see a similar pattern going into the next edition. And this class will then be focused more towards giving the next generation of sailors the opportunity to get into the class. And what we really have seen is that we have a problem getting team builders to work to find teams, to bring teams to the race. And that's why we opened up for the second class, the Amoca class, that I will come back to. And that this also, we've seen already since we launched the preliminary notice of race with an idea for a crew rule, which really pushes for a majority or more than a majority of the crew being young, which in our sport means that one group should be under 30 and another group should be below 26. That has sparked interest from young people that are, you know, seeing, well, this is an opportunity now. So they say, we want to try to get our own teams together. And wouldn't that be wonderful if a team of, you know, 25-year-olds get their group, get their team together, then they will keep going for another 20, 30 years, hopefully. This class is something that I think we all who love boat technology, when we look at this class, we just say, wow, they look so cool. And for each generation, each edition that comes out, they just look more and more amazing, just like on this shot that was taken, I guess, a month ago. And you just think, yeah, this is right. This is what we want to do. Of course, we realize that any development class comes with a careful set of decisions when it comes to how to balance, so it doesn't become too much of an arms race when it comes to money. But this class has proven to have been around for 30 years. Of course, as Mike points out, this now, how will that now be able to combine it? And it's not easy how we can combine the two classes, or the Volvo Ocean Race type of mentality with the current single-handed teams. But I think at the basis we found a true interest, and people realized that in our sport that is so scattered, if we can combine the efforts of those that are doing the main events around offshore sailing, that could only be good. But it takes compromises from everyone, hopefully not too much, so we can come out as winners with a really strong event and a strong Amoca class. And this is something that's close to heart to all of us. And I remember when we went into the Team SCA, we said, if we don't bring women back into the race will die. And I still believe so. And I think it's not a question. This race, you know, the journalists finally started to ask the likes of Pete Burling here, how does it feel to sail with women? I think those questions were very common in the past. Now it's, you know, it's normalizing a bit more. A long way to go still, but we will keep pushing in this direction with crew diversity in both classes in terms of gender. It was great for the last race that we had women in skippering roles, in navigators, as boat captains, as watch captains, and also on the team winning the Volvo Ocean Race for the first time. There were now women. So the direction is good. It requires careful attention to keep it going. Sustainability is at the very core of the race. It's very natural for us to work on ocean health. And I will not go deeply into this more than to say that we do everything we can. And the beauty of us now sort of deciding the purpose and the vision of the race is that we will work very hard on this, because we believe in it and we think it's important to use this opportunity we have with the race that goes around the world, that brings people, connect continents with continents, and spread the message. We will keep running ocean summits every year up until the next race, and we will develop a great program. And again, Dee, I will leave more of that for you to talk about, because my clock is red here, I can see. So to close off then, the end is coming near of 2018, but we'll reveal the new name and identity soon. The notice of rails and we will open for entries. We'll come 12th of December, I think, Phil. And we are procuring host cities. The race course should be set by mid next year. And we're already underway with the sustainability program as we speak. We have another group present at our Ocean Conference focusing on that. So with that, I close, and this photo, I mean, there are many photos of this race, but this is what it's about. It's about the athletes. They are great role models, and they love the sport more than any others, and they spend more hours than anyone else out on the water, so it's all about them. Thank you very much.